such a hurry.
I can tell you.
Consider how we live. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome. Happy June. It's a beautiful new day and a new month. Please stand for our opening song. Surely the presence of the Lord will sing one time, 398. Heavenly Father, we do come into your presence. We come to give you glory and praise. With thanksgiving in our hearts, Lord, we come together as believers, as one family in Christ, that we might lift up your name and you will be praised, that we'll be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer, in Jesus' name, amen. As we continue our worship, Shine, Jesus, Shine, we'll sing all verses of 290.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the dark. The shining Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us. By the truth you now bring us, shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, flow, Spirit, bless, set our hearts on. From the shadow into your radiance, by the blood I may enter brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine.
Praise him at 300, all verses.
Praise him, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory. Give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. our blessed Redeemer. For our sins he suffered and bled and died. He, our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail him, Jesus the crucified. Sound his praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep and strong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals, loud with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song.
Let us continue to praise him with 97, We Sing Praises.
I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to your name, O Lord, glory to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing glory to your name, O Lord, glory to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Let us continue and prepare for a time of prayer. Jesus, let us come to know you, 768.
Jesus, let us come to know you. Let us see you face to face. Touch us, hold us, mold us, hold us. Only let us live in you. Jesus, draw us ever nearer. Hold us in your loving arms. Wrap us in your presence when it comes, bring us home.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing this morning? We're so glad that you are here to worship with us, even though it's a dreary kind of day outside. We're so glad to be in here where it's warm and where it's dry, where we can worship and praise together. We are going to look at our prayer list and talk about any additions or updates that we might have or praises. Amber. That's awesome. We're praying for Amber's doctor's appointment. You said it was Thursday for her hip. Be praying for that, absolutely. Yes.
I have a big praise. Tripp Scott Ellis joined our family on Thursday morning at 4:08, and mom and baby are doing well, and big sister is loving it all.
Huge praise, huge praise. All right. Pat. So she's going this week to back to the doctor. Okay. So Lee, from her procedure, still has her drain in. So pray that there's a good doctor's visit this week and that it can come out and that there's been some healing that's happened. Right. If there's nothing else, then let's take this time and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning just humbled by all that you do in our lives each and every day. Father, we are so grateful for all the ways that we can see you working, not only in our life, but in the lives of others around us. Father, for the praises that are mentioned this morning, Father, we just give you thanks for every situation. We know that you are working, Father, and we are just so grateful to be a part of your kingdom at work. Father, for Lee and for Amber, upcoming appointments, Father, we ask that you would, in each situation, that you would show up and show off. That you would provide healing, that you would provide comfort, and that you would just be able to show that you're in control, that you're in power through each and every situation. Father, as we continue to worship you, as we gather around the table, as we dive into your word, Father, we ask that you would fill this place with your presence this morning and that we would receive the message that you are sending to us this morning. We thank you, God, for all that you do for us each and every day. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we prepare for a time of communion, let us sing 228, all verses of Oh, How He Loves You and Me.
What he did there brought hope from
I'm sure that some of you might have noticed that during the last song, I come over here and sat in front of Metro. I didn't aim to distract anybody, but there's a reason for this. If you're ever having a bad day and you come to worship service, go sit beside Metro if you need an upper. I don't say this to embarrass him, but I have always found in my experience here that when I sat by Metro, I start thinking that I'm as good a singer as he is. And I think it's just because he drowns me out and I have all of this comfort. But I just get excited singing when I sit beside Metro. And so next week, all of Metro, save that whole section, everybody will probably be over there sitting beside you. But Metro reminds me of, like, sometimes on television you'll hear people described as, oh, when this person walks into the room just lights up. You ever heard anybody say that? I use Metro as an example here at church when it comes to our worship, because as we look at the scriptures this morning in our Sunday school class, there were a couple scriptures that I wanted to share with you today. It comes from 1 Colossians chapter 27. The first one says, "To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of his mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope and the glory." And then skipping down to verse 29, "To this end, I strenuously contend with all the energy Christ so powerfully works in me." And this is just a good reminder to us, is that we know the truth. We're going to celebrate communion here in just a few minutes. The truth, the mystery that God has revealed to us, is his plan for salvation. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, so that all of those who believe can be enter into heaven along with him. But I want to focus on verse 29 because it talks about the word energy. And what I just explained to you earlier with Metro is energy is transferable. If you are full of positive energy, it makes a difference on those around you. If you are full of negative energy, you sap the energy out of those around you. So as we think about the message that has been revealed to us, we need to remind ourselves that we should be nothing less than full of energy and positivity all of the time. And so as we go through this communion time, just reflect on your attitude for the moment. Is there someone that you need to increase your energy level with? Is there a change that needs to occur within yourself so that you don't keep sapping the energy out of everybody else around you? Let's go to the Lord and pray. Father, we come to you this morning, and we're just thankful that we know the story, Father, the story of your salvation, and how if we believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, that we can join you in heaven. But Lord, we come to you also humbly admitting that sometimes we don't spread this message and we don't serve with the energy that we should have. And so, Lord, help us to increase our energy level. And Lord, there's no better way to do that than just to think about all that you've done for us. And so, Lord, we just pray that as we go out of this building today, that you put opportunities in front of us to spread your word with the highest amount of energy that it deserves. For this we pray in your name. Amen. Amen. Here at VCC, we practice open communion for anybody who's baptized according to their faith. We welcome you to join with us. If you don't have a communion cup, just raise your hand and we'll make sure that you get one. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to our next of chapter ceremony and service. Today we are here to honor the young adults. Some of them have just graduated. Some are getting ready to graduate. Some have chose to join the workforce, and some have chosen to get their GED. And some just haven't quite figured it out yet. But that's okay. We aren't meant to write our whole story. Many of us in this room have graduated, have quit school, changed careers, left jobs, been fired, went back to college, left college. We have made good decisions and we have made bad decisions. Some of us have completely rewritten our stories from where we thought we would be at the ages of 17 and 18. And some of us are still trying to figure out what we want to be when we grow up. No matter where you currently are in your story or what you want your next chapter to be, we want you to know two things. First and most importantly, that God loves you. He has already written your story for you, whether you realize it or not. You can always turn to Him for answers. It doesn't matter how complicated. Secondly, everyone here this morning is proud of you. That doesn't depend on your current circumstances. And you have jumped through many obstacles to make it here today, and you are here. Welcome to the next chapter of your life. Let God guide your hand as you continue to write, and we will be here to help encourage you and keep you going any way we can. Can I have the young adults come forward for the ceremony? Allie, Justin, come on forward. We have 7 young adults this year, some of which couldn't make it. Either they're at a job or on their way to Florida, which who wouldn't go to Florida? And some just couldn't be here this morning. So we have 7, and we'll name them all, but the 2 that were able to come this morning is Justin and Allie.
If you guys don't know, we have prayed over these Bibles since we've gotten them, 3 weeks ago. And it's an honor to hand these Bibles out to this young man and young lady here, and all the ones that will receive their Bibles. Justin, we're so proud of you.
So proud of you.
We thank you for being here and being a light in our world.
Okay.
We also have Allison Dillard that couldn't be here this morning.
Nice.
Woo-hoo. And it's Allison Dillard again. Same boy. How did we do that? We have 2 for Allison Dillard. She gets an extra.
Oh, okay.
And then we have Lewis LePage that couldn't be here this morning. Quentin Thompson that couldn't be here this morning.
Nice.
Hayden Boss that couldn't be here this morning. Nice. And Braden Hendrick that couldn't be here this morning.
Nice.
So we thought it was important, so this ceremony used to be for graduates, and we thought it was important that we honor all the young adults that are going out into the workforces, into life, because as all of us know as adults, that it doesn't get any easier. And we think when we're young, we're going to just be able to wake up one day, and we're just going to walk outside, and we're going to be ready to go, and life's going to happen, rather good or bad. And so our biggest concern is that we equip these children, these young adults, with God's word. And so they have the sword. Whether they read it or not, it's up to them. And we hope they do open them, but they have God's sword in their hand now, so.
So Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11 says, "I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future." And so as these kids leave today, I leave with them my favorite passage of scripture. And just not only leave it with them, but also leave it with each of us. As that we go out into this world, we just pray and realize that God's guiding our way. So we just right now just want to pray over these two and their journey going forward. Lord, we just come to you this morning and we just thank you for the accomplishments of these young adults. Lord, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit and for your promise that your plan for us includes prosperity and hope. So, Father, as we go forward into this world, each and every one of us, not just the graduates, we just pray that you open and close the doors. Open those that you want us to go through. Close the doors that we don't need to go through, Father. And so, Father, as we leave this place today, we put our complete trust and faith in you, that no matter what lies ahead of us and what lies behind us are just tiny matters compared to what lies within us. For this we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody stay after service because we have appetizers downstairs.
Consider how we live our lives today. Everything is run, run, run. We bolt our breakfast, we scan the headlines, we race to the office. The full schedule and the split second, these are our gauges of success. We drive ourselves from morn to night. We have forgotten the meaning of the word relaxation. What has become of the old-fashioned ways, the simple pleasures of life? Who can forget, for example, the old-fashioned band concert at twilight on the village green? The joy, the serenity of just sitting and listening. This is lost to us, and this we should strive to recapture. A simple, innocent pleasure. And so I say to you, dear friends, relax. Slow down. Take it easy. Watch your hurry. What indeed, friends, is your hurry?
What's your hurry? That's a good question. As we finished up our prayer series this past week, I thought this was a very appropriate message that was brought here this morning. When I ask, what's your hurry? Hans came up with, this is his answer. We'll just go with that. When I ask that question to you, what becomes your hurry? We live in a fast-paced world. We live in a world where everything is now, 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 as quick as we can get it. Where you can order, if I wanted to order on my phone, if I wanted to order off Amazon right now, I could probably have it by Tuesday. Maybe Monday if I'm lucky. You know, it doesn't matter what we do in this world, it seems like everything is going in a hurry. When we think about that, though, how much has that changed in our lifetime? You know, Andy Griffith's show is a classic. I grew up on Andy Griffith. It's a great show. But, you know, I listened to that preacher talk about stopping and enjoying the simple pleasures of, you know, slowing down, sitting on the front porch, those types of things. We don't do that anymore, do we? At least, maybe that's a generational difference. I don't necessarily do it. But we live in such a fast pace, go now, I want it now, I'm going to get it now world, that everything that we do, it seems like in life right now, is based on how quick we can get it. You know, one of the funny things when I thought about this was I remember dial-up internet. That was a big thing when I was little. Dial-up internet. And I think about dial-up internet and that right now, when when I think about it, I think about how fast we thought it was back then compared to now. Dial-up internet, if you wanted to load a web page, you'd probably be there for 10 minutes trying to load it, and we thought that was fast. Now, if we got to wait 10 seconds for it, we're like, well, call the internet company, it's too slow. Times have really changed. We've gotten into a faster and faster paced world, and therefore we as people have gotten even faster. We want to go, we want to go. Things need to get done. We've got a laundry list of things to do. We've got to keep going, and we forget to take time to slow down and enjoy the simple pleasures, like the preacher said. Back then, years ago, we didn't have the same stress that we do right now. We had different stresses. We had different things that would bother people back then. But we still took time to relax. So today, I have a question for you guys to answer among yourselves. What are you doing to slow down and to relax? What are you doing to slow down and to relax? I can speak for myself and say nothing, because my life is so fast-paced that I really forget. I forget to slow down and to relax. I forget to stop and smell the coffee. I forget to stop and just sit down and just relax with my wife and my kid. I forget sometimes to stop and to thank God for what He's done for me, because I'm in such a fast-paced mode that I get to doing this, to do this, to do this, to do this, and all of a sudden it's time to go to bed and I have forgotten to do any of that. No show of hands, but can anybody else relate to that? I think if we're honest, we all can relate to that. And it's very interesting and funny, the first verse that we're going to look at this morning. If you have your Bible app, this was the verse of the day this morning. And it comes from Genesis chapter 2, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 3. It says, "And so the heavens and the earth were completed and all their heavenly lights. By the seventh day God completed His work which He had done, and He rested on the seventh day from all His work which He had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because on it He rested from all His work which He had created and made." Now, I want to ask you a question that might sound like a Sunday school question, but I want us to think about this. Did God need to rest on the seventh day? No. Could God have created the universe, everything that we see, in one day, ready to go, here we are? Could God have done that? I think we can all agree yes. So we see from this verse, and we see from what we know of God, that God is giving us the example. Starting off at creation, God is giving us the example of we need to take time to rest. That is so important for us as human beings. When I am very low on sleep, I become grouchy. Anybody else feel that, relate to that? I don't know, you ask my wife how bad it is, I guess. She'll give you an honest answer, I promise. But we all need to sleep. We all need to rest. It's what God has designed us to do. Hebrews 4:10. "All who have entered into God's rest have rested from their labors, just as God did after creating the world." See, in the New Testament, we see an example that reverts back and reminds us of what God did. We see that example as God did after creating the world, this idea that we need to rest. We need that time. Paul reminds us that this is what God has done. Now, this next verse from Ecclesiastes, I think about a funeral when I think about this. We use this verse during funerals a lot, and when we're upset and when we're down, but this is also a time, or this verse also reminds us that there is a time to rest. In Ecclesiastes 3:1, there's a right time for everything. For everything that we're going through, for every emotion that we have, there's a right time for that. But then we see in verse 7, there's a time to be quiet and there's a time to speak up. There's a time to be quiet and there's a time to be fast-paced. Let's put that in today's time frame. There's a time for both. And we need to be able to find what God is calling us for our balance. We are called to rest. Now, the question that we have is, you know, resting is good for us. It's good for the soul. It's good for our mental health. Rest has all these purposes, but there's also another reason that we need to rest. And in Psalm 46, verse 10, it says, "Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God." Psalm 37, 7, "Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him." When we are busy moving, do we miss things? I do. I don't know about you guys, but I do. If I'm running 100 miles an hour, if as soon as I get off work, I'm thinking about, I've got to cut the grass, I've got to go ahead and weed eat, I need to do this. Okay, this has to get done today, and it is 6 o'clock, and I have to eat dinner at some point, and I'm like, okay, if I don't start now, I'm not going to get it done. And so you run through, and you run through, and you run as fast as you can, and then before you know it, you're eating dinner, and you're sitting there. If you're like me, you're falling asleep on the chair with food on your lap. My question is, how do we know when we're that busy or we're in those mindsets, how do we know what God is wanting us to do if we are that busy? How do we know what God wants us to do if we're that busy? There's times where Kimmy will be talking to me and I'm in the middle of something and I won't even realize she's talking to me. There's times my phone rings that I don't know that it's going on because I'm so zoned in on my tasks that I do not know what else is going on around me. And I don't know if you guys are that way or if it's just me, but that's where I am. And it's hard to know what God wants me to do when I'm that busy. Another verse that's very encouraging comes from Matthew 11, 28. "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. The next slide is a very funny kind of way to remember this whole story. Does everybody remember the story of Martha and Mary? Where Martha was so busy doing the day-to-day tasks and Mary was so busy listening to Jesus, they were each doing the opposite things. And Martha got upset with Mary because she goes, "Jesus, she's not helping me. She's not doing what we need to do." You know, social cues say, "I need to do this. I need to do these things. I need to prepare these things for you, Jesus. I need help doing these things." And see that Jesus said she's where she needs to be. "Lord said to Martha, 'Dear friend, you are so upset over all these details. There's one thing worth being considered. Mary has discovered it, and it won't take it away from her.'" Mary had discovered that listening to Jesus was important too. Listening to Jesus is just as important as the things on our to-do list. It doesn't always seem that way up here, and I understand that, because I'm right there with you. It's hard when there's a mound of things that are piling up, a load of work that needs done. Sometimes it's hard to slow down, but we need to. I think as I transition to Hans, I think this is a very appropriate thing for us to think of. If you are too busy to pray, then you are busier than God wants you to be.
So, now that we've slowed down, now what? What do we do? What do we do with our extra time? Well, you got to remember, we're in a spiritual warfare. We have an enemy that's looking to steal, kill, and destroy. And Peter says that here in this 1 Peter 5, chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. Be alert and be of sober mind. For your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith. If Satan wants to sabotage your life, he will sabotage your thoughts. Jesus tells us in Mark chapter 7, verses 20 through 23. He was talking to the disciples after telling the crowd, your souls aren't harmed by what you eat, but by what you think and say. It's pretty profound. He asked the disciples, don't you understand either? Can't you see that what you eat won't harm your soul? For food doesn't come in contact with your heart, but only passes through the digestive system. It is the thought life that pollutes. For from within, out of men's hearts, come evil thoughts of lust, theft, murder, adultery, wanting what belongs to others, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, pride, and all other folly. Satan is going to make you worry. He's going to make you want, he's going to make you anxious. He's going to try to distract you. He's going to try to destroy your marriage, your job. He's going to make you busy. He's going to make you, he's going to distract you with sports, with videos on social media. He's going to make you work probably more than you should. He's going to distract you, and he's going to make you think that you don't have enough time for God. I'm too busy. But remember, we all have 24 hours in every day, and how we spend that is important. James tells us in chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, so submit yourselves humbly to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And when you draw close to God, he'll draw close to you. Peter told us to resist the devil. And James here tells us the same thing. He continues on. He says, wash your hands, you sinners, and let your hearts be filled with God alone to make them pure and true to him. Make your heart pure. Then your thoughts will follow. Jesus told us in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. How much time do you spend seeking other things first instead of God? I struggle with this. I get distracted very easily. I get distracted with sports. I tend to watch too much of it now. I'm doing better. I've cut back. The news. I've got to know what's going on in the world. So I tend to watch news too much. Some of the social media videos. You know, those quick 30-second videos that are entertaining. They're funny. They're cute. But I find myself watching them. And before I know it, it's been an hour. And I'm like, oh my gosh. I just spent an hour watching videos. What could I have done better with that time? So what do you do first? What do you put first? Once you've identified them, now we can work on reducing them or eliminating them to free up more time. So how do we spend more time with God? Well, we can seek God through prayer. Paul tells us here in this verse, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and everything give him thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So what does pray without ceasing mean? It doesn't mean that's everything you do in life is pray. But it does mean that you have consistent prayer life, always talking with God through frequent and consistent prayers. Paul reminds us of that in the next slide with Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, through prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. There it is, your hearts and your minds. We're not supposed to be living with anxiety. And Paul goes on to say, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Our thoughts are to be on these things. Positive things, and not things to worry about. We're not supposed to worry about work, the economy, or politics. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, 34, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Now, Paul tells us to take every thought captive in obedience to Christ. How much better would our relationship with God be if we did this? How much better would our lives be if we did this? There are many ways to take our thoughts captive. And I've found a few ways that I'm going to share with you. So first of all, I'm a computer guy. And so how many passwords do you use? So you can make your computer password a scripture that you want to memorize. You can memorize a few scriptures that way, and I've done that. Our passwords are supposed to be long and complex, right? So scripture fills that requirement pretty easily. What better way than to have Philippians 4:13 as your password? It's over 8 characters. Now, actually, the minimum number of characters for your password should be 12. It has upper and lowercase letters, it has numbers, and it has a special character. Or how about Matthew 12:37? That verse is, your words now reflect your faith then. Either you will be justified by them, or you'll be condemned. Wow. What are you going to be thinking about when you enter in that password? You always say the verse, or at least I do, always say the verse as I'm typing it. So that puts those thoughts in your mind. Set your screensaver to come on after 10 minutes of inactivity, and then set it to require a password to log back in. Before you know it, you'll get good, really good at memorizing scripture. The second way I found is when you wake up every morning, greet the Lord. I talk to him and say, good morning, Lord. Thank you for a good night rest. Hey, be with me today. Protect me and guide me. What a better way to start your day. It sets the tone. The next one is read the Bible. So you might want to get up a few minutes earlier in the day and just read one chapter. Once you get into the habit, you might find yourself reading 2 or 3 chapters. Some days you'll find yourself just reading more and more. Track your progress, and in a short amount of time, you'll be amazed at how much you have read. And I'm sure that these are just a few of the ways that I try to hold my thoughts captive. But you'll probably have a few more. So, finally, your assignment for this week. You didn't think you were going to get an assignment this morning, did you? You don't go to church to get assignments, right? But yes, this week you've got an assignment. And you won't be graded by JD and I. It's just something that to think about and to try to work on. So what if we found ways to slow down and free up time for God? What if we could hold every thought captive and obedient to Christ? What would our days be like if we spent more time with God throughout the day? Well, we would need to put God first, and that would be a good day.
It'd be a great day when we put God first in our thoughts, in our minds, and as we slow down. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this time. Father God, we come to you this morning and we're with a heartfelt apology that we've gotten so busy with our lives that we haven't put you first. Father, help each and every one of us this week to make a much better effort, a conscious effort to put you first, to slow down and not let life get distracted, to capture our thoughts and to put you first and to communicate with you more. Father, help us to grow closer to you through this week. Help us to understand what it is you're calling us to do. Help us to do all these things this week. Father, we thank you for your word and for just our ability to be able to read your word and to grow closer to you through it. Father, we thank you for the relationship that we have with you and for all that you do for us each and every day. And it's in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we prepare for our time of invitation this morning. We're going to sing When We All Get to Heaven. And if this is a great time, if you would love to join our church family or accept Jesus, this is that time to come forward. But this is also just a time we can sing, we can praise the Lord without the distractions of life. So let's stand and worship the Lord without the distractions. Just a couple of announcements. Reminder that there are refreshments downstairs for anybody who would like to attend and celebrate the young adults. We would invite you to come. What? Embrace your youth. I like that. We can embrace our youth downstairs in the gym. Just no broken bones, please. Reminder for the church camping trip at Starve Hollow. We're going to be doing a lot of fun things, right, Larry? A lot of fun things out there all weekend. So make plans to come out and just hang out with us and enjoy a great time of fellowship anytime that you can make it out there. Okay, two campsites still available. So if you've got a camper and would like to come join us, see Larry about getting one of those. It's going to be a good time. It's going to be a good time. Are there other announcements? No? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I know. Anybody can sit down. Wayne has some has an announcement for us. He's going to come up and talk to us about.
Grandpa is slow, but then again, he's old. Has anybody been to the grocery store lately? Well, let me put it this way. Has anybody not been to the grocery store lately? I think if you've been, and everybody has, you've been shocked when you got the bill. It doesn't take much, not even a cart full anymore, to make $150 due to our galloping inflation. I, for one, have always liked Arbor corned beef hash. I like it for breakfast with an egg on it. $4 a can. I like V8 juice. It's good for you. $5 a bottle. Just a few of the examples. Well, we have a new ministry here at VCC that I'm very proud to tell you about. We are opening a food pantry or food bank, whatever you want to call it. Now, we didn't really ask for this ministry. We didn't even think about having this ministry because there's one in Brownstown, serves this end of Jackson County. But folks, this ministry was brought to us and given to us by the Lord. He said, here's everything you need, go with it. There is a need, there's no doubt about that. There's a lot of hungry people out there. There's a lot of people with fixed income, low income, that have just had to cut back on their groceries or put things back on the shelves even because of the prices in the grocery store. So, we're not competing with Brownstown. We're in conjunction with Brownstown. There are other churches that are involved in this now. There's a food bank at Kurtz and at Freetown, and Medora has just got on board this week. Nadal has talked to them, and they're willing to start. So we're going to have our food connection. We'll be starting up, excuse me, in another week or so. This has just been a wonderful opportunity for all of us, for all of the churches in this area. I've given you some quick prices. Now, picture a 20-foot trailer, enclosed trailer, which Brownstown Christian Church has and has loaned to us to use. Picture that trailer half full of food, like this deep, 8 foot tall, this deep, full of food for $250. There is a ministry over at Osgood that gets donated food, and for $125 a pallet, we can go over there every Friday and get a load of food, and that's what we've been doing. Bring it back, distribute it to the other food banks that I mentioned to you, including Brownstown, and they all pitch in, and we all benefit from this ministry over there. Now, we have set up ours in the old basement right under this part of the building, and I would invite you to go down and walk through and see what God has provided. We have shelves in that room, in the room to the other side. They are full. And I'm talking good food. We have two freezers that are full. Just coming to mind, spaghetti sauce, baked goods, 15-pound bags of sausage patties, Good stuff, folks. And it's going to be available for anybody that needs it. No charge, no strings attached, no questions asked. Just come and get it. And I'm sure that the word is going to get out around the community that we have this. Now, this is great. We're wonderful. We're glad to do it, but we have an ulterior motive. When these folks come in on Tuesday night to get their food, Tuesday afternoon, we can invite them to stay and have a meal with us. We have one every Tuesday night. Good food, good fellowship, nice time. So this is just a chance, again, to slow down, come in, and have a reason to stay. Now, make sure I've got everything here that I need. We've reached out to Brownstown. We've reached out to Freetown, Medora, and we're going to help supply all these food pantries because we have the means to do it. Few months back, God sent us a person, and he came, stand up, Nadal, so people know who you are. This is our manager. He's going to take care of this operation. Any questions? Nadal came with the ministry of taking food to the homeless folks in the area, Bloomington, Salem, and around. And all he asked us for was a place to store some of his food. Well, we had the place, no problem. We were glad to do that. And so this has grown now to this opportunity to where we could reach out to all the communities and through all the churches, plus the wonderful fact that we're getting the churches to cooperate and all work together on this project. We will be supplying Seymour, Driftwood, Brownstown. We're hoping that Brownstown Baptist will come on board soon. We now have a fully functional food pantry. Have all that we need. But we do need people. We need volunteers for working on pantry day every Tuesday. We need volunteers to help on Fridays. This is a big job to go over there to Osgood and load up that food into the trailer and then to take it around and unload it at the churches. But we also have need for people to come and greet. We have need for cooks, bakers, clothing organizations, meat and freezer produce repackaging, or just show up, show love to these folks that come in. No matter who you are or how old you are or how young you are, we'll find a job for you. We have sit-down jobs, we have stand-up jobs, we have reach-out jobs. Any and all people and donations are going to be welcome. Let's see. Oh, there is a sign-up sheet at the entrances so that we'll know who we have coming or how many. And so far, we've had some wonderful volunteers that I would like to just give credit to that have helped out immensely. These being Shay Fleur, Kaylee Jackson, Patton Jackson, Bill Hunsinger has been a godsend. He's been here day after day and helped Nadal set up the shelving that we have down there. Shelving is a two-man job. It's virtually impossible for one person to put up shelves. So Bill has just been a great help in that area. Also, Louis LaFleur has helped, and Haley Gorbett has helped in this area. So this is it's good to get the teens involved too, but we appreciate all the help that we can get and look forward to a great ministry and a great outreach in the very near future. Thank you.
Okay, Pat has something to add.
I don't want anybody to go away with the wrong impression. When they're talking about getting a pallet of food for $125, that doesn't mean they're going to come up there with a pallet of food and set it in the vehicle. They bring pallet after pallet after pallet past the vehicles that are receiving. And then they tell you how many of each item that your allocation is. And you place the, and you have to take those things, and some of them are pretty darn heavy, and you have to load them in your trailer. It's a good deal of hard work on ancient backs. So the more younger backs that might be free on Fridays would be really, really, really well appreciated. Thank you.
What an awesome ministry that is. If there's nothing else, we will go ahead and we will stand and we will have our closing prayer and we will sing our closing song. So let's go to God in prayer at this time. Father God, we are just so grateful we've been able to be in your house this morning, to dive into your word and grow closer to you. And Father, we're just so grateful for this kingdom work that we can be doing here at VCC so that we can further your kingdom here on this earth. Father, as we go through this week, I ask that you would place a hedge of protection around each and every one of us, that no matter what Satan throws our way this week, whether it's busyness, whether it's insecurities, whatever it is, that Father, we could push those thoughts, push those things away. We can focus on you. And we can come back here again next week to be renewed and refreshed by you. Father, we thank you for all that you do for us each and every day. Protect and guide us this week. It's in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.